Welcome to Love Fellowship Believers, a non-denominational church desiring to fulfill God's will. We invite you to join us in an atmosphere of praise and worship and the powerful teachings of Christ delivered in a most creative way that reaches every age. Located at 1900 Martin Luther King Jr. Boulevard in Greensboro, North Carolina, on the wonderful campus of Gillespie Park Elementary School. This year, we're focusing on building a foundation solidified by grace, with walls made by faith, and our homes being filled with salvation by being united in living devotion. We promise you, visiting us online or in the sanctuary will be an experience that will be life-changing and one you'll never forget. We hope to see you soon. Services begin at 11 a.m. Have a blessed day.
Come on, thank you. Thank you, Lord. Amen, amen. Amen, amen. As it was mentioned, we're going to do something a little bit different today. Ephesians 6 and 12, Colossians 1, 16 and 17 are some anchoring scriptures. Amen. It's going to be talking about what we're going to do. In our Bible study, we've been going through a series called Know Your Enemy. And by going through this series, there's so many folk that have come and have talked about just how much of a blessing this Bible study has been, just how much this Bible study has helped them through the different things and trials and tribulations that they've gone through. And so thinking it not robbery to go ahead and share in our 11 o'clock service so that everyone else could also get it. Amen. To praise God that some folk might be able to get this and get some deliverance in their life. Amen. It makes a big difference when you know who your enemy is. Amen. And how you will combat against your enemy. Amen. So what I've done is I've asked Deacon Edmondson to go ahead and put together some slides so that we would also have some visual. There also are going to be some printouts. My ushers have some printouts for someone that says, you know what, hey, I like those notes. I might want to actually look at those notes. And for those folk that are technical, we have a website, amen? If you go to our website, and as you navigate to our website to the Bible study section, once you click on Bible study, the actual form is actually out there on the website as well. It's going to ask you for a password. And the reason we have that password there is so that anyone that would be hacking or whatever wouldn't be able to get directly into it. But the password is LFB Bible. LFB Bible. And so if you have your phone and you want to go to our church website and you want to navigate to the area that says Bible study, then you click on Bible study and it'll ask you for your password, LFB Bible. And up under all of the different things that we've gone through Bible study, you'll find a section that says Know Your Enemy. And it would allow you to actually download it to your phone. Amen. Amen. If you want a copy, again, our ushers have some. If you say, well, hey, we ran out of copies and you need some more, we'll make sure that we have some next Sunday. But in case you need to get it before then, just let me know and I'll go ahead and send it to you. And if you want to come and participate on our Thursday night Bible study, you're more than welcome to come on out and participate with us as we comb through this a little bit more. Amen. Amen, amen. I don't want to stand here and take credit for what we're getting ready to go through because I did not put it together. Dr. Got to make sure I say his name right. Basile Frazier. Thank you. Dr. Basile Frazier actually put this together out of Texas. I actually gave him a call and let him know that we were actually going to be using a Bible study that he had put together entitled Spiritual Warfare. And he was elated to know that it was being used in this way and said that possibly he would actually call in on our online streaming to be able to listen to what we're going through. Amen. Amen. So know your enemy. What we're going to deal with is actually where did the enemy come from? Amen. Let us pray. Father God, first and foremost, we say thank you. Thank you, God, for this time and this moment, God. Thank you for being who you are, God, and allowing us to be here. Lord, we ask that you would open up our hearts and minds, that we would be receptive to what thus saith the Lord here in this place. God, we need you and cannot make it without you. God, bless us that we would be blessed, for we love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen, 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 amen. Know your enemy. As I was saying, it's important to know who your enemy is. Now, we read Colossians, and we read Colossians 1, 16, and 17. And what that basically did is it broke it down to let you know who created everything. Amen? It says, for by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, the things that are visible and the things that are invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him and for him. It says, and he is before all things, and by him all things consist. All things were created by him, and all things were created for his purposes. When we went to Ephesians chapter 6, what we actually dealt with is we found out that there's a battle going on. And the battle that goes on is not between me and you. The battle that goes on is not between you and another individual. But there's actually a battle that goes on against principalities. Amen? The enemy wants to tear you up, destroy you, kill you, get rid of you, and to not even have any thought that you ever existed. He just doesn't want to steal from you. He just doesn't want to take from you. He doesn't just want to kill you. He doesn't want to just destroy you, but he wants to make sure that there was never a spot where you used to stand. That's how bad he wants you gone. But I'll come here to share with you today that the enemy does not have any special type kind of power. See, a lot of times we've heard, anybody ever heard somebody say, the devil made me do it? And we've even heard the song, you showed me what the song was. Kurt Carr, where it talks about the devil has the power to look into your future. That's not true. We just read scripture that says he created all things. Did you know that Lucifer was not created as Satan to begin with? Over in Genesis chapter 1, amen? Genesis chapter 1. If you want to write these down, you can, and go back and look at them later on. Genesis chapter 1, it says, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. He created everything. All the heavens, the earth, he created everything. And in creating everything, he created the angels. Everybody know what an angel is? A heavenly host, referred to in the Bible as God's stars sometimes, angels. He created all of these angels. Well, as the Bible would have it to go, that in creating all these angels, there's a portion of these angels that became misled. They were misled by someone named Lucifer. Lucifer, who was created, as the Bible lets us know, Lucifer, who was created to go ahead and to be the head worshiper. If we look over in let's see, this is going to give me the scripture I want. Amen. Bear with me for 1 second, please. If we go back and we look at Genesis chapter 3, Genesis chapter 3 talks about the fall of mankind. We'll find out earlier in the Bible that on the sixth day, God said, everyone that was created, everything that was created was good. angels were created at this time. Angels are created different than from me than you. Me and you can point back to a mother or father and actually can point back to a birth date that we were born. But the Bible goes ahead and lets us know that angels were not created that way. All the angels were created all at one time. No angel is more powerful than the other, but they had different jobs. They had different things that they were supposed to do. And Lucifer was created to be a worshiper. Lucifer was created to go ahead and that through worship, he was the one that was in charge of making sure God received the worship that he deserved. Now, in doing so, what happened is that Lucifer got caught up. He got caught up in going through that. That's why the Bible lets us know that pride is a terrible thing, that thinking more highly of ourselves than we ought to is a terrible thing. Lucifer's job was to be in control of worship, but not for him to be worshiped. But in the process of being so close to God and dealing with all of that, Lucifer got caught up in himself and had a thought to go through his mind. And his thought was that he could get folk to worship him the same way God was being worshiped. He could get the angels to worship him the same way the angels were worshiping God. And in the process of even having the thought, he was cast out of heaven. And now being cast out of heaven, the Bible describes and things are happening and it feels as though you're being tore up over demonic presence, understand there's two more that's on your side. Yeah. Amen. Amen. So a third of these angels went with him. Now, if you look in Exodus 20:11, if you also look at Nehemiah 9 and 6, you'll understand here that again, it still talks about God being the creator of everything, of every single thing. And I ask you the question, which is greater, the creator or the creation? And so if the creator is greater than the creation, how is it that the creations would ever have the ability to overpower the creator? Can somebody get that in their mind? If God is the creator of all things, and you've now given your life to God, then how is it that his creation, whether it be the enemy, whether it be another person, whether it be a circumstance, whether it be a situation, how could it ever overtake you if the creator is on your side? Yes. It's powerful when we can get in our mindset to know who our enemy is and how he operates to try to come against us. It's powerful to understand who we are in the creator's eyes. So I told you that there were angels, and there was angels that were created. And not that Lucifer ever did it, he just thought about it. And in the process of thinking about it, he was cast out of heaven. He had one chance. The third of the angels that thought that they would go ahead and jump on his side had one chance. My question to you is, how many times have you messed up? How many mistakes have you made? Even in Genesis, when Adam and Eve were disobedient, they were still given another chance. You today, us today, when we mess up, we're still given another chance. And so it just makes sense that those that would oppose us and that would be our enemy, when we look at Lucifer and a third of the angels that's gone with him, it just makes sense that they would have some malice in their heart towards us. because they didn't get a second chance. Maybe the question might even be asked, God, why would you give mankind a second chance but never give me a second chance? I can't answer that question. But I can tell you that God loves us so much that he gives us another opportunity to get it right. Amen. He gives you another chance to line up with him. And because of this, in Genesis chapter 3, you see this story of a serpent. You see him being conniving in all of his ways to try to have mankind to fall. Because if he can erase mankind, if he can take away every single gift, every single talent, every single area that God has blessed us in, then that would make him look better. Ever been around a group of people and there's someone in that group that tries to do it this way? They say, well, I'm not doing better than what I'm doing. And so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna talk about everybody else around me. I'm gonna try to spread business and mess about everybody else around me. And in doing so, I'll look like I'm more than what I am because I'm making everybody else look less. Y'all follow what I'm saying? And so what happens sometimes is that's exactly how. And so if you can go ahead and say, you know, that man that you created, you know, you keep forgiving him over and over and over. That's why when we look in the book of Job, we see that the enemy goes to God and he says, you know what, Job, I'll make Job talk back against you. You know, all you've taken care of him, you've done all out of all you've done, I'll show you that he's not worthy. Yeah. This is the same way the enemy tries to attack us today, to try to show that we're not worthy. Amen. But God loves us so much, he gives us time and time and chance over and over and over again. Amen. Would you take your Bibles and turn to the book of Ezekiel? Ezekiel 28. Ezekiel 28, verses 12 through 19, talks about a king named Tyrus. And in talking about this king and describing him, he also is using a two-part here to actually break this down. Amen? And when he's talking about that, he talks about, I will destroy the cherub, and I will do this, and I will bring thee. It says, son of man, take up a lamentation against the king of Tyrus, and say unto him, thus saith the Lord God, thou sealest up the sum full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. Thou hast been in Eden in the garden of God. Every precious stone was thy covering, the sardis, the topaz, and the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, and the jasper, the sapphire, the emerald, and the carnelian. And gold, the workmanship of tabrets and of thy pipes was prepared in thee in the day that thou wast created. Now, although we hear and see is talking, and it says lamentation against King Tyrus, we're seeing the same type of similarities when we're talking about Lucifer being created for worship. It says, thou art the anointed cherub, verse 14. Covered, and I have set thee so. Thou wast upon the holy mountain of God. Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. Thou wast perfect in all thy ways from the day that thou wast created, till iniquity was found in thee. Verse 16, by the multitude of the merchandise, they have filled the midst of thee with violence, and thou hast sinned. Therefore I will cast thee as profane out of the mountain of God, and I will destroy thee, O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire. Thine heart was lifted up because of thy beauty. Thou hast corrupted the wisdom by reason of thy brightness. I will cast thee to the ground. I will lay thee before the kings, that they may behold thee. Thou hast defiled the sanctuaries by the multitude of thy iniquities, by the iniquity of thy traffic. Therefore will I bring forth a fire from the midst of thee. It shall devour thee. And I will bring thee to ashes upon the earth in the sight of all them that behold thee. All they that know thee among the people shall be astonished at thee. Thou shalt be a terror, and thou shalt never, and never shalt thou be any more. Here's that same story I was telling you about, is that he was created, Lucifer, as this cherub, as a covering, as though to bring in worship, but because he allowed different things to come into him. It's the same way that happens with us. If we know our enemy, the enemy has no power over us, but if we allow him, to come into our lives, then we'll start to see all other kinds of stuff to happen. That's why it's important how we communicate with one another. It's important how we communicate on Facebook. It's important how we deal with situations to make sure that we're careful to not allow the enemy to come into our lives. Amen? Amen. Amen. I want you to look at another scripture. Or before we look at that other scripture, one of the other areas that I want to point out here is that verse 15. It says, "Thou was perfect in all thy ways from the day that thou was created until iniquity was found in thee." Each and every single one of us, because of sin, because of Adam, is born with an inherent sinful nature. In other words, those of us that have had children before understand that you don't have to teach a child to do wrong. A child already knows how to do wrong. We have to teach the child. It's our job to teach the child to do right. And so we're born with an inherent sinful nature. But on the other hand, the Bible says that the angels were created perfect. What now took away them being perfect is when iniquity entered in. Not that iniquity forced itself on them, not that sin forced itself on them, but they had to allow it to happen. Although we have an inherent sinful nature, the wonderful thing that God did is that he did not create us as robots. He created us with the ability to make a choice. Every single one of us here has the ability to make a choice of whether to do the right thing or to do the wrong thing. Now, we can try to fool ourselves all day into thinking we don't know the difference between right and wrong. And oftentimes, that's exactly what we do. We talk ourselves into the choice that we want rather than the choice we know we should make. Because our flesh has a desire to please itself. And so I can look at a situation and say, I really shouldn't go do this. I really shouldn't go over there, but I want to. And so the choice then is made. Made to actually do the wrong thing rather than do the right thing. And when we make a choice to do the wrong thing, what that simply is doing is us opening up a door. What that simply is doing is us cracking a window. What that simply is doing is us taking off a piece of our armor to allow the enemy into our lives. Amen? The Bible talks about there's a full armor that we should wear. You'll find that, I believe it's in the book of Ephesians, that he says that there's armor that we should wear that starts at our head all the way down at our feet. In other words, to make sure we cover our mind, to make sure we cover our heart, to make sure we have a shield to fight off, to make sure we have a sword, to make sure that we even guide our footsteps in every single thing that we do. If we falter in any of those areas, it's then when we open up for the enemy to come in and take over. Amen? I want you to look at over in Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 14. Isaiah chapter 14. Isaiah chapter 14, verse 12. It says, "How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thy heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit." Here is Lucifer saying in his heart, I will ascend and be greater than God. And in me being greater than God, I will be the one that's worshiped. It says a lot when we put ourselves in positions that we shouldn't be in. Understand, Lucifer himself was just a wannabe. The devil himself is nothing but a wannabe. He has no power over you. Know who your enemy is. Everything that you go through, none of it has power over you. You have the ability to speak into every single thing that you go through. That's why folk can stand up and give a testimony and say, this was my situation. And in my situation, I began to speak to it. And in speaking to my situation started to change. Now, your situation won't change with doubt. Your situation won't change if you don't yourself believe it can actually happen. The enemy himself tries to grab us, hold us, and to have us to look at our situation and have it to appear to be something different than what it actually is. And so if I perceive in my mind that I am less than who I am, then I'll never see myself being more than what I am right now. If I perceive in my mind that I am less than what I am, I'll never actually have the reality to believe that I'm better than I am. God has a greater set up for us, but if we don't ever believe it ourselves, how will we ever see it? Amen? Lucifer is the original name given to the devil. The term Lucifer means the shining one. This is interesting because we can see that God created Lucifer to reflect God's glory. However, now he only appears as the angel of light, but is the angel of darkness. He uses deception to mess us up. Anybody ever seen a full moon? Okay, I wasn't great in science, so I'm gonna need your help. So we only have like 5 people that seen a full moon before? Okay, so we got a few more people that seen a full moon. Anybody ever seen the moon, period? How about that? Can we got anybody that's ever looked up at night and seen a moon before? Okay, and so when we see the moon, science teaches us. Now, I've been to a lot of different countries. I've been to a couple of states. I've never been off the earth, okay? Well, I guess I've flown to different places, but I've never been outside of the earth's atmosphere. I'm not an astronaut. I'm just telling you what science teaches us, amen? Science teaches us that the sun actually is the power of light, the sun. You know, the sun that we see up in, that's actually the power of light. But because of the way that the planets orbit the sun and the way that the moon orbits the earth, based upon all that geometry and angulation and all that other kind of stuff, the reflection of the sun makes the moon appear as though it has its own light source. Are y'all catching what I'm saying? And so, if we're not careful, we can get caught up looking at the moon as though the moon was the light because of the reflection and not really realizing it's actually the sun. We can get caught up actually thinking that the enemy is the power source based upon where we're looking because of the reflection of the light from the Father that shines. And so what happens is that folks start to think that the enemy has more power than he does when the only thing he's doing is just reflecting the light. And so that's why you have folk that are starting to give more energy and more power over to the enemy as though he was something and he's actually not. I want to talk about some of these things here in Isaiah. In Isaiah 14, here the enemy says what he's going to do several different times, and want to try to break that down. He says, for the Lord will have mercy on Jacob and will yet choose, 14, where did we start at? Isaiah 14:12. How thou fall from heaven, O Lucifer, how thou wilt cut down from the ground. Verse 13, for thou hast said in thy heart, I will ascend into heaven. So the creation is telling the creator in his heart what he's going to do. See, that's the type of God that we serve, a God that knows what you say in your heart. And he says, so in his heart, he will ascend into heaven. He assumes that he's going to take over God. He says, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God, to indicate as though he would have authority over the angels. He says, I will sit upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north, to refer to the temple as though he's going to be exalted. He says, I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. The clouds that would be the covering of God's glory. He assumed that he would take God's place. But then in looking at this whole thing, if we see verses 15 through 17, it says, yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. They that see thee will narrowly look upon thee and consider thee, saying, is this the man that made the earth to tremble, that did shake kingdoms, that made the world as a wilderness and destroyed the cities thereof, that opened not the house of the prisoners? Is this the devil? That there's going to come a time where the enemy will be revealed and will actually look and say, is this the one that caused all of this mess? I mean, is this who I gave all of that power to? In realizing and looking at my situation and my circumstance, you mean I got fooled by this? We talked in Bible study. A lot of time people talk about being victorious. I want to share with you that you're not victorious, but that you are the very essence of victory. Pastor, what are you talking about? If a person is victorious, that means there's an act that has to happen for you to be victorious. I'm here to tell you that the act has already occurred. Lucifer was cast down to this earth to basically do whatever he wanted to do, however he wanted to do it. God even grants him permission. He doesn't have the ability to start to attack you in your life and to start doing things without first getting permission from God. And so the very things that Lucifer sets up to mess you up are the very thing that God allows to build you up.
That's right.
Pastor, what are you talking about? Well, let's think back to some situations and some things that have happened in your life. If you hadn't gone through some of the things you've gone through, you wouldn't be who you are today. If some of the things had not occurred in your life, you wouldn't be as strong in that area as you are today. Now, there are some things in our lives that we've gone through that we've allowed to actually take the situation and allow that situation to make us weaker. But it's all in how we look at it. Sometimes we look at our situation as a glass half empty, and we complain about the part of the glass that's yet to be filled, forgetting that there's a portion of the glass that's already in there. Well, Pastor, you don't know what you're talking about because my glass is empty. Well, have you been thankful just because you have a glass? Because there's some that don't. Some folk, when they go together, they have to use both hands to try to carry it. God has allowed you to have a glass. And so the situations that we go through, God actually uses the devil. It says that the devil was created to bring God glory. Amen. Did everybody hear that part? It says that he was created to bring God glory. He was in charge of making sure God received glory. Maybe this is just my convoluted thinking, But I think Satan is still doing that.
Yes, sir.
Because I believe that God's word doesn't come back to him void. Pastor, what are you talking about? How is Satan still giving God glory? He's giving God glory through you and me. Every time he takes us through a situation, a circumstance, and we choose to tell God thank you anyhow. Anytime he allows us to get beat up, you know what, maybe you just that type of worshiper that God says, I got to allow you to go through some more stuff because I need your thank you just a little bit more. Maybe the worship that's inside of you is so valuable that God would tell Satan, look at the book of Job. Satan is sitting there with God in the midst of the angels. God looks up and says, yo, what you doing here? He says, I'm trying to figure out who I can destroy, who I can tear up. He wasn't looking for Job. God then says, have you considered my servant Job?
Come over here, man.
In other words, why don't you take Job through? Because I know at the end of it, what Job is going to do. And Satan, whether you realize it or not, I created you to bring me glory.
Yes, sir.
I created you to bring me worship. I created you. You are in charge of praise. And you might not be doing it the way that you think you're doing it, but I'm the creator. You're the creation. You don't even understand. I'm still using you.
Yes, sir. Yes,
through my people.
Yes, sir.
And so now, maybe instead of me looking at my situation and saying, man, I'm going through. Got my head down, walking through, moping, kicking rocks. Maybe I can now look at my situation and say, you know what? God loves me enough for me to go through. And if he's allowing the enemy to take me through, I know that he hasn't created me just so that he can destroy me. So maybe he's allowing me to go through so that I can get to the next thing to be even better. And so now, instead of complaining and being tore up, why don't I just go ahead and tell God thank you? God, thank you for allowing the enemy to come into my life. Because if you've allowed him to come in my life, you've obviously given me what I've needed to be able to deal with him, to be able to move to the next point. Lord, maybe you just want my worship. Lord, maybe you just want to hear me say thank you. When the last time you told God thank you and meant it? I don't mean you just came to church and somebody said, let's tell them thank you, let's put your hand. When's the last time you had a praise break without somebody prompting you? When the last time on your own you got caught up in the car? You got caught up in the shower? You was just walking at work one day and it just hit you and you just, found yourself in a place where you had to excuse yourself from work. Look, I got to take a break. I got to take a break. Because he's been just that good. Or do you wait till the situation happens? God takes you through it. He allows you to come out on the other side, and now you want to tell him thank you. Maybe we're going through some of the stuff we're going through because we don't do what we're supposed to do. Maybe he allows the enemy to attack because, you know, in front of folk, we can act a certain way. It's real easy to do it in front of folk. But when we're behind closed doors and can't nobody see us, we act a different way. And maybe God say, well, what you showing everybody over here ain't lining up with what's going on over here. So I'm allow you to go through some stuff out here so that you can go ahead and give me some stuff up here. Amen. Amen. There's a part that talks about names. Names that the enemy has taken on, names that the enemy puts on himself. I'm going to go ahead and read off a couple of these names. If you've pulled this up online, or if you get one of the sheets, you'll actually see the different scripture references that go along with it. So we have gone through and we've talked about where did Satan come from? Where did the enemy come from? Listen to some of his names. A destroyer, an accuser, an adversary, one who stands against, the angel of the bottomless pit, the Antichrist, one that is against Christ. Again, in a different language, the destroyer, Beelzebub, the god of flies, Belial, the devil, a false accuser, the devil, the slanderer, the enemy, the evil spirit, the father of liars, the god, little g, of this world, the great red dragon, Lucifer, man of sin, a murderer, an old serpent, power of darkness, prince of this world, prince of power of the air, ruler of darkness, Satan, the serpent, son of perdition, the tempter, the thief, the wicked one, Diablo, the rock thrower, stone thrower. I thought that one was pretty interesting. The stone thrower. Well, how is that? How is that something? I mean, a stone thrower? What happens if I'm standing here and I throw a rock against that wall? When I throw a rock against that wall, the rock is going to hit the wall, and some people are going to turn around to look that way instead of being concentrated on what's above. And so the enemy sometimes throws stones in your life so that he can get you off focus. And if he can get me off focus, if this is what I'm supposed to be focused on and he can get me off focus, then he has the ability to catch my attention to have me tore up over something else. Understand, the enemy does not have any power over you. The only power that he has is what you allow him to have. And so if every little noise that's made distracts you from doing what it is God would have for you to do, every time you're distracted, you're opening yourselves up to allow the enemy to step in. That's why every little situation that comes your way shouldn't bother you. You ever met somebody, everything that happens throws them off. Every single thing that happens throws them off. Okay. I got a little bit of road rage. Can I share? I'm gonna be transparent. I got a little bit of road rage. I can't stand somebody to be in the left-hand lane going 50 miles an hour. That gets on my nerves. And seem like every single morning or every single time I got to rush to get somewhere, I always find that person. I always find the person that's going slow in the fast lane. I always find the person that don't know where they're going and they in the car just looking around. I'm like, Lord, I just need to make a turn. Would you? Seems like I always find that person. My wife would tell you, it get on to the point that my, you know how your kids repeat what you do? To the point my kids got in a car with my wife one day and it was a situation was going, and I wish they just move. I was like, really? Ooh. She came home and asked me about it. Still to this day, it bothers me. And I'm doing my best. It's an area I'm working on to respond differently. And so now when it's something that bothers me and tries to get me off, instead of me complaining about it, now I say, just Lord help. Lord help. Bless you, Lord. Bless you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. If you would start to respond differently to your situation, then different things will start to occur. If you was to make the choice to say, you know what, the next time I feel that pain and I can't get rid of that pain, the next time that migraine headache come on, the next time they get on my nerves, the next time it just bothers me, you know what, instead of me complaining about it, instead of me losing focus, you know what my response is going to be? Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Because nothing is happening to me that you don't allow. And so if you're allowing it to happen, you're revealing an area that I need to do better in. And so why don't I use this as an opportunity to tell you thank you? I'm here to tell you that it'll start to change that situation in your life. Instead of every time something happened, you want to jump on social media and tell everybody about it, why don't you just go on social media and just let your post be, thank you, Jesus. Start going ahead and letting that be what you tweet. Thank you, Jesus. Go ahead and get a picture of something on Instagram, and when something happens, say, thank you, Lord. Watch and see if your situation doesn't start to change. Amen. Amen. We're going to go ahead and end right here for today. What we're going to talk